Okay, welcome. My name is Rikke Seim. I'm in charge of this Teamo Challenge along with my colleague, Signe Poulsen. And a special welcome, of course, to Rasmus from the Work-Life Barometer, who's here to present the challenge. The challenge that he and his colleagues are facing currently, and that they would like for you to work with the following weeks. And when you hear Rasmus talk, please bear in mind the Teamo curriculum and especially the three core models, the SWOT analysis, the STAR model, and the business model canvas. So I think we will divide the room in three parts. So this part over here, if you bear in mind the SWOT analysis, listen to what Rasmus is saying, and if you have the enough information to carry out a SWOT analysis, if not, obviously ask Rasmus the questions you need for the information you need. And the middle part here, if you would please focus on the business model canvas and the value proposition. And the last part, there's a bit of noise up there. Okay, but the last part over here, if you will please focus on the STAR model, if you have all the information you need to carry out a STAR model analysis. Obviously, you're not so many people over here. Then this afternoon, you will have a further opportunity to work on the challenge with the information you've got from the presentation here today, and also from the written case description, which is uploaded on Insight. Hopefully you found it already. And this afternoon you can share your preliminary analysis with your fellow teammates and with the TAs. Let me see what. Obviously also the presentation that Rasmus is coming with now is also available on Insight. So if you want to take notes, it's on Insight already. Yeah. Okay, and for those of you streaming, the Twitter channel is also open, so if you have any question, don't hesitate, use the Twitter channel. So, I'll give the floor over to you, Rasmus. Here you go.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Wave the hand. Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and happy to be here. It's my second time I'm presenting our business as a Teamo case. Last time it went well, I think, so and we got very good feedback, so I'm looking very much forward to this session. First of all, before kicking off the presentation, I'll just give you a short background on who I am. I'm Rasmus Hartung, as I said. I studied at Copenhagen Business School. I graduated in 98 with a master's degree, and been working in IT consultancy businesses quite a while. And in 2014, I stumbled upon this project that I will present to you today. So point is, you be aware where you end up. You're studying engineering, and there's no guarantee that you are will be working as engineers when you graduate or later on. You might, like me, started in the business school area, and now I'm working with psychologists. You never know where you end up. Anyway, let's kick off. Oh, one thing then. I think there was a typing error on the support, the dollar sign. That is what I call wishful thinking. We are not there yet, but hopefully we'll we will be making money on this project eventually. The agenda we put together is a company presentation. Then I will give you some insight on who we are, the team consists of, walk you through the solution we built. I'll go through the technology, so sort of a little bit of on the infrastructure, Howdy in numbers, and give you some insight on machine learning, because we are collecting a large number of data, and obviously we can also, as anyone else, use machine learning to improve our services towards customers. So I will give you an insight on that. And that could also be, you know, kept in mind whenever it comes to the challenge, if there is the areas where we should focus instead of doing what we're doing today. But I'll get back to all that later. And then finally, present a challenge to you. If you have questions, please pop them as we go along. And I'll try to navigate. If there are too many questions, I might park them to later, or I will quickly answer them if I'm able to do that. All right, so let's look into who we are. The company was founded by myself and two other guys. We are all coming out of IT, so we are not sort of specialized in this well-being area that is predominantly within the psychology area. But we have been working with business development for many years, and especially in the consultancy industry. So what we did was basically we took up the challenge at that time, like you're taking up my challenge today to you. We took up a challenge at that time where we met with the Danish Psychiatry Foundation, where we heard from a director that she stated that it's a shame that nobody do a more clinical way of prevention. And she said also that with the technology available today, somebody should be able to do something smarter than what's available on the market today. The current case back in 2014 was that if you Googled it, like we did at that time, you will find that whenever it comes to prevention and avoiding burnouts and stress-related sick leaves, it's very much the pension companies in the Danish market, pension and insurance companies, that would offer you a conversation with normally a nurse. And what they called prevention was that you only have to be sick for like 2 weeks, and then after 2 weeks you could have a conversation with a nurse. When we thought about prevention, we wanted to get in front of people before it actually developed into a sick leave or into a bigger problem. So that was our mindset around prevention, and we couldn't really find anything on the market at that time that supported anything on that. So the way we did it was basically we took a brand new idea. We thought about what it would require, and basically came to the conclusion that we need to get in front of the person and ask that individual person, how are you doing? And we know we can't ask the question that way. We need to be a little bit clever in the way we are asking the question, but that is really what it's all about. That is to find out, how are you doing? And that is why our app now carries the name Howdy, because that's short for how do you do. But we realized we needed to be get a little bit more evidence on the way we asked the questions, and we Googled our way to a scientific model called WHO5 that was developed by a Danish professor. That the WHO5 is a well-being scale. It's what's called a psychometric scale, and it's used to determine people's well-being level. And we thought about it and said, wow, that's fantastic, because we have 5 working days in a week. So that's one question for each day. That later turned into, after having conversations with the professor, actually, because he got a bit excited about our way of thinking. So we met with the professor and got a feedback from him that he suggested that we should not ask a question every day. That would probably be a little bit tiring on the long run. But he suggested instead that we do it fortnightly. So every 14th day, we will be asking questions about the person's well-being level. And I'll get back to you a little bit later how all that works. But basically, why I'm telling this story is because the professor at that time also said another thing, is, and that was where we caught his attention, and says, this is a new way of thinking, and we haven't seen that before. He's a professor psychiatrist, and he's a professor in psychometrics, which is the science behind questionnaires. I would probably be insulting him a lot by putting it that easy, but that is basically what it is, and that's what he's been studying for a decade, or many years, sorry. But he actually said the way we think about this prevention, he would call that being a new paradigm within the scientific terms, which is quite big actually, because nobody has done this before in the way we thought about doing it. That is, on the one side, was a good thing, because we're first on market. Nobody have done it before. Competition is not existing. On the other hand, we also have to go and educate the market. We have to go to each and every customer and explain them that this is an okay way of doing it. And that takes time. And that is, that is one of the reasons when we explain ourselves why our business has not grown as fast as we have hoped for. That is one of the reasons that we are looking into. But basically, what we did, we was not funded by a capital fund or anything like that. So it was our own private money. And we decided that we need to test the idea in the market because, as I said, it was a new idea. So we built a prototype, we made a PowerPoint presentation, and then we called a marketing agency and asked them to book meetings so we can go and visit different customers. And I remember we celebrated the first day the marketing agency had been calling out, because they booked 12 meetings in one day, which is absolutely a big number. I come from the IT industry, and whenever we would have an agency booking meetings, it's like more like 20 meetings a month. And this was 12 meetings for one day, and it was really, really prominent companies. So that was very, very promising. And then what we did was we went on the road to visit customers for, quite some months. I think we had 250 meetings booked, where we simply drove around the country and met customers every day to get their feedback and tested the idea and so on and so forth. And we succeeded getting the first customer in October 2014. Yeah.
Okay, I didn't find the written challenge yet, so if it's in there, I am sorry. But your customers are the companies who would then use it for their employees, or?
Yeah, good question. Thank you. I will cover that later in my presentation. But yes, we decided when we took the product to market, we could go to a B2C, take a B2C approach, or we could take a B2B approach. As we are working within work environment, we also know that improving working environment is not coming only out of the individual person and improving the individual person, but it's also coming out of improving the organization, the groups, the leadership teams, and so on and so forth. So with that in mind, we decided that this is a solution we will be building towards the companies for the employees. But the components that regards the individual monitoring, that can be applied into a B2C segment if you want to do that. But the competition in that segment is quite high. There are self-monitoring tools are available from many different companies all over the world. So stepping into that would require something else from our business. And then I heard numbers that it's like, is it $5 per sign up on your app? It costs you in marketing. So getting the marketing machine and the B2C users to sign up on your app is quite expensive. All right. So the team today, consists of we are 12 people. We are covering the classic activities like sales and marketing. We have brand and design inside our own company, and technology and development are part of what we do in the Work-Life Barometer company on the Howdy solution. The team is what you see on the board here, and then we have two external investors. That is private investors that we pitched and asked for whether they would be interested in stepping into the company, and they did that in the beginning of 17 to fund the company. Then we're working with partners, and partners is we have different type of partners. Part of our service is that when you answer the five questions I talked about before in the Howdy app, and you score low on your well-being, we have a team of psychologists that would call you up and talk to you about how you're doing, and give you an advice on how to move on with the current situation. These psychologists are not employed by ourselves, but a service that are delivered by a partner or by a subcontractor, if you will. Then we have sales partners. Sales partners is to us normally insurance companies, as pension and insurance companies, or it could be health companies like Falck Healthcare. That is one of our partners. It could also be SOS International. That is not one of our partners, but it could be. And that kind of type of companies that normally we would have some added services to put on top of our existing product. And that kind of partners, they would be covering sales and implementations to our customers. So we would be stepping into a role where we would be pushing out the technology through a sales channel of partners. So that's what we're doing partly. Some of our business is done directly, and some is done indirectly through these partners I'm talking about. But there's also the insurance companies. They are focused on this because if you have a pension scheme that consists of your savings and it consists of insurances, and pension companies have one insurance called your ability to work. If you lose your ability to work, you would the pension companies are paying out a huge amount of money in compensation to the person that gets get on sick leave and maybe not recover in a fashion where they can work again. So they will also be selling our products, or we will try to set them up as partners. Yeah.
We just have a question here.
Who has access to all the data that you collect, like from the employees?
It's a good question. It's a very good question. There are four letters that takes up all my time these days. It's the GDPR. I don't know if anyone heard about it, but on the 25th of May, all companies in Europe is moving into a new data protection law, where we have to be compliant with whatever says in that new law. We can, as a Danish company, we come from what's called Datatilsynet, so the data inspection, where you need a license to be able to deal with private data. We have always been under the data inspection, so we have sort of been approved by them to register and to deal with and to store the personal data of the people that we have on the system. But we are now moving towards these new laws and are adjusting a bit bits and pieces. But to answer your question about who owns the data, it's when we enter into agreements with customers, with the companies, and these companies are the data owners of the employee data. When they send an employee list to us, we need to have an agreement with the data owner, meaning the company, because we would then act as a data processor. So whenever we're receiving base data for the company, that would normally be first name, last name, email address, phone number, and some organizational data, we receive that in a role as a data processor. Then we asking, then we're starting to invite users to our system, and we can do that legally as we have the agreement with the company. At the minute where the person is accepting our consent, our role is changed from being data processor to data owner. So we are now the owner of the data. And we're taking that role for a number of good reasons. And one is, most important one is that we know to get the most accurate answers and reliable answers, you need to make sure that the company you work for will not get access to your replies. So we need to keep a high level of anonymity. I can't say that word, so sorry. We need to keep high level of anonymity to make sure that that the company will not get the details in your answers, whatever you replied. And to make sure that never can happen, we need to have the role as a data owner. And the person would then be in the role to us, and basically cutting out the company on the data exchange. Did that answer the question? Thanks. All right. So, sorry. So last time I've showed this. I showed this slide, but all this talk about partners made a bit of confusion. So just to be very clear, I included this slide. It's an org chart on how we organized and what we role we are playing. So we are trying to we worked our way from basically three people in the company. We started out two, actually, me and Espen, and then Kasper came on board later, and moved towards getting more people on board, and thereby also needed to specialize in certain areas, so we were not stepping on each other's toes every time we needed to go to see a customer, or we needed to make improvements on the app or whatever. So this is how we have organized ourselves. We set up a professional board with Jens Munk Hansen as the chairman. He's one of the investors. The other investor, he's not officially on the board, but he sits at the meetings. That's Carsten Dilling. I don't know if you know him, but he's heading for the chairman position at SAS. He has the chairman position of NNIT, and he's the former CEO of TDC. So he's a good person to have on board and to open doors towards the larger companies. And then Espen Gunnar, who's a partner in the company, is on the board. I'm the CEO. And then we specialized in roles where Gunnar is covering new biz, Espen is covering existing customers to make sure that they're happy, and also to sell more into the existing customers. And then we have Mass as our CTO. He replaced Kasper. That's one of the sad things about a startup where we lack of funding and we are moving forward, but not maybe with the speed that we thought. So Kasper decided to leave the team. Even though he was one of the co-founders, he decided to leave the team half a year ago. So we have replaced him with another person that believes in the project. And then we have Jennifer, who is covering Sweden, where we have set up an office in Stockholm. So this is how the company is organized. The market we're looking into a huge potential. On the market, we have decided we want to cover the three countries, Denmark, Norway, and Sweden. We're currently in Denmark and Sweden, looking into Norway. We could argue that we could take this product all over the world. There's an option for that. But on the other hand, we're also looking into a huge potential just looking into these three countries. Within 1 hour, we can reach each other, so we can be face to face with customers within 1 hour, which is a benefit compared to if we had an office in the US. That would require a lot more to travel abroad. So we have that was one of the things we took in as a design point, at least for the version one of a company. We don't want to move into, or we don't want to move outside of Scandinavia. On that, I think the number speaks for itself. Our product is not really tied to any industry or any type of organization. Unfortunately, stress is all over, and it's recognized by many companies as a real problem. Looking into WHO, they state that in 2020, stress and the related sicknesses out of that will be the largest disease, and that is, as you know, just a few years from now. So this is taking up a lot of space, and especially in the pension companies that are paying out insurances to people that lose their ability to work. In numbers, we have around 105 customers, 18,000 unique users. We have more than 300,000 well-being messages. We have 1.5 million unique answers, and have 5,500 cases through our system. And cases in this sense means conversations between our psychologists and employees of our customers. And this has been built up on for the last 4 years.
When you say you have 5,500 cases, is it just a registration of the we had a conversation, or is it a sort of a how did this develop, or what do you register?
Yeah, good point. We register. we like to think that our business model, we like to think as a little bit as an iceberg. And that should be understood in a way that as we are asking 5 questions every 14th day to everybody in the organization, also the people that are not feeling stressed, they are feeling well, they don't have any problems, but they would like to participate because it contributes to the organizational understanding of the well-being in my company. For that reason, we need to build some technology where we have our disturbance is very low. And on average, we know it takes about 35 seconds to answer 5 questions. So we're asking the persons for 1 minute a month in general. So that is the very top of the iceberg in terms of how much disturbance do we make in organization. Then if we detect a low level on the well-being, we would be calling up from our response center. A psychologist would call up the person and have a conversation. That would normally be around 15 minutes to clarify what's going on. And 15 minutes is an average, so in the lighter cases, it would take less, and vice versa. When the conversation is sort of done, we ask the person if it's okay to register the reason for the conversation, and normally, the person would accept that because that is also anonymous and goes into the statistics that are hidden from the employer to know who the person was. So we put a reason code on the case. And the reason code could be it's split into two, so it could be work-related or it could be private. The private one we don't detail out, but on the work-related ones, it could be problem with manager, problem with the colleague, harassment, bullying, whatever, too much work, and reasons like that. And that goes into the report that is shared with the company in a statistic form.
It's about the relationship between the users and the psychologist. Is that like a random setup? Is it, or is it the same person they talk to each time, or is it new one?
It's random.
Okay.
And that comes, in the beginning we had one psychologist that called up the same person, because the service we offer is that we call up the person, they don't call us. So we have added in the proactive action. And in the beginning we made sure we can have two calls on one case. So we have the first call, and then we have a potentially a follow-up call. Not all cases need that, but in some cases it does. And in the beginning we thought it was important that it was the same person. But the type of the dialogues we have in our response team is more lightweight. So it's treatment in a classic way. It is prevention, and it is a matter of giving a good advice or giving out tools to what you can do. And we detected that it wasn't that important. It was the same person that called up. So yeah, that was a very long answer to a very short question. So no. Yep.
Yep, there's several other questions.
You have 105 customers, but you somehow have 18,000 unique users. What are unique users then?
Sorry?
What are the unique users you have? What is that?
That is the employees. That is the individual person. So a customer in our, that is the company, and the user is the employee.
You just talked about how you handle cases, and this is lightweight. Do you have somehow that if it cannot be handled lightweight, you make a recommendation that people go to a psychiatrist or something? Do you handle that part also?
Yeah, we handle it in a way. I mean, when we made the design of the solution, we were stepping into an area where we knew that on the treatment and the help, when you are registered as sick, you just line up in a queue for people that or companies that would like to help you and take your money to help you, but that's a different thing. But that was a market, that was what I would call a red ocean. That's a really, the margins are penetrated. There are many, many, many very skilled companies that are doing extremely good services in terms of getting people back on the right track. So we didn't want to step into that area. On the other hand, on prevention, nobody was really doing anything on prevention. So we wanted to make sure that we covered that area, but we didn't want to take the service all the way through. So what we do is that we give the advice to the person that with the knowledge we have from your company, i.e. you have a private insurance that covers psychology sessions, you can call this number. And you can have a conversation with a psychologist. And just to make sure that you actually do it, I will call you in 3 weeks. So that's sort of the way the system works. I put it a little bit more nicely than probably I just presented it, but that's basically what happens. And we have seen that people is actually acting on this. But it's not only to use the health insurance, it's also to give a little bit, a little push to make sure that people actually act. Talk to a manager. I mean, he's a good guy. And if he's not, then talk to your representative that would be sort of representing the employees, or talk to a colleague that might be able to help you. Or if it's privately, talk to a partner at home. And then we would be giving out advices what to do, what the techniques to open up the difficult conversation, and so on and so forth. How can you get help if your kids are getting harassed in school or whatever? So that kind of things. Yeah.
You mentioned that you split the responses in terms of work-related and then private, and then the work-related responses get summarized into a report for the company. Mm. How often does the company receive that report? Because there could be a timing issue between them receiving the report and the action time that they could take, and then also who has access to that report once it's delivered to the company. Is there a dedicated response team to deal with that?
We deliver the reports every month. So every the first of the month, we're sending out the reports. It's been sent out normally to the HR team, the top management, and to the individual managers. And the report, the content differs. So normally a line manager would get the well-being data for his own team, plus an overall perspective on how is the company in general. and that's it, where the HR team would get all the details on different departments. So they can act on a low level well-being score in a certain area, and they can pick that up. But basically, when we have a red alert in a team, normally it's a bit too late to actually solve that particular case. That's why we have a psychologist that talks to the person to sort of help that person and get back on track. But we accumulate this into a report to tell the manager, listen, you need to change the way of your leadership. You need, if that's the case, yeah, you need to you know, get help to improve on this. Yeah.
It was just in regards to when you implement the tool into the companies.
Sorry,
when you implement the tool into each company, do the users have to accept, for example, that you call them up beforehand?
Yeah.
And how is that done? Is that just a code of conduct? Because it's actually the company that chooses and decides to implement it.
That goes into the consent. Yeah. So in the consent, in Danish is samtykkeerklæring, but in the consent, it clearly states what data do we collect, and what for what purposes are we using the data we collect, and who are we sharing the data with.
Regarding the questions, are these always the same questions, or are they interactive, so dependent on the answers the people give before, or no, how does it work?
They are, it's the same five questions, so they are repeated again and again. The disadvantage is that some will get bored, we know about that, but we see the majority of the people using our tool is actually using our app to reflect on their well-being. And if you want to reflect and you want to compare yourself with the previous measure, you sort of need the repetition and you need to repeat the questions. So at the moment, that perspective have sort of won the battle, whether we need to make it more interesting on the questions or whether we have to stick to the same questions, even though knowing that it might bore, some will get bored about it.
When you implement your question system to a company, do you then only do it if it's the entire company who does it, or can a subsection of a company participate and others don't? Just let's say you ask a employee and they don't want to participate, do you then not work with the company, or?
No. We normally, a lot of our customers are startup with the pilot. So they run a pilot to see if it fits into their organization. Is it adopted by the managers? Will the user use the tool? Can we see the effect, and so on and so forth? And when that is sort of over, we will be rolling out to a smaller or larger group. Or we will be closed down. But
So I'm a little curious about your market. Since stress is a thing that's present in almost everywhere, do you have any idea why people choose not to use, or organizations choose not to use your product?
No, that's a challenge.
Do you have any market research or any data from your sales or marketing divisions?
from existing customers that terminated. We have been on a journey where we are building up the data, and when you start out with one customer, and you know you have maybe 10 customers, and you're growing the business, but it's still a limited number of informations. So when we are discussing this internally, we often end up in the situation with, you know, this customer A left. Yeah, but that guy was also an idiot, you know, or they didn't understand us. So, that kind of things where we know exactly the reason why they left, but we couldn't get the managers engaged and so on and so forth. And we're continuously looking into these things to see if you can see any patterns. And the clearest pattern we have seen is where we have the acceptance from the managers, and we have the sort of the top management if have their interest in our tool, and that we have been used not just as a well-being measure that is voluntarily for the manager to use, but actually the manager is forced through other programs to work with the well-being in his or her team. We have a continuation on our subscriptions to a higher degree compared to when it's not used, when it's used to a more individual tool. But it's very much about what you're looking for. Are you focused on only getting the answers on the app? Then we are failing in some cases. If you're looking in to do we actually get a relevant number of people in our response team, meaning that we actually capture those that have a problem. If you look at that number, we have a very good case actually, because we have what we put in front of the five questions is what we call a nudging engine. So we build a sophisticated engine that reminds you about your well-being. So we have 50 different templates depending on the stage you're at, making sure that people are engaged into answering the questions. And we might not get a question for a person that are super duper happy and don't need any support from us. If his manager or her manager is like, yeah, you can use Howdy, you can don't, I don't care, I'm not using it in my reports, then that person would normally not reply to our questions. But as long as they don't opt out, they stay on board on our communication, then they will get the continuously messages from us. And if they end up in a situation in their life where suddenly a parent dies or whatever could happen, the few days later, the Howdy nudging engine reminds you that there's actually a service that can help you if you're feeling not well. That person would be more tempted to go and answer the questions and probably end up in our response team than if we didn't have the nudging engine running. So we see a benefit from that. All right, I think I will move. Oh, sorry.
Sorry, last question. Can it work in the opposite direction? If a manager has a concern about an employee or a team member of his, can he push something to you that you can then push to the device of the user to potentially collect information if it was something that they'd maybe picked up on during the work cycle?
Not today, but it's a very good question, because we are introducing a new module we call Howdy Manager. That will be monitoring the well-being level on teams, on group levels. And if we detect a low score compared or benchmarked with our 1.5 million answers, if you fall into the low category, you will be called up by a psychologist from our response team and talked about the issues in the team. And there will also be sort of And the manager will have an option of making a please call me or please contact me. So an inbound and an outbound hotline service. And that has been just released within the last few weeks. All right, so just, I don't know, there's a risk I covered a few of the next slides in the replies, but thank you very much for very, very good questions. Let me just touch base on why preventive actions matters. I took out some numbers from various sources. So if you look at from a society point of view, there's a cost of 27 million Danish kroners a year. They're registered 1.5 million sick days, sick leaves due to stress. That's quite a lot, and quite costly. If you look at from a financial point of view, PFA, that's the largest pension and insurance company in Denmark, they lost 0.5 billion kroners. They had premiums, meaning pay-ins, of 1.5 billion, and they had insurance claims for around 2 billion. So they have a direct loss of 500 million kroners. And we know that around 40% relates back to stress. So this is a topic where some companies is really, really burning a huge number of money on payouts on the insurances. And then we have SKAT, is one of our customers, so the Danish tax authorities. They have a business case where we have 1,200 users on Howdy, and they save around 6.5 million a year if we do calculations on the cost of an average person home due to stress. That is also in the material or the handouts that you got. And then from science, this is coming from a professor called Martin Schelling that I happen to know from, he's a professor at Karolinska. He's also the chairman of the Swedish Psychiatry Foundation. And I met him for lunch a while ago. And he had a very good comparison, I think, and that's if you break a leg, you put it in a cast and you have 2 weeks rest and the leg is back again. If you have a burnout, yes, 2 years of rest. And I think the most worrying statement is there's no magic pill. And keep in mind, he's a doctor, he's a psychiatrist, and he's, you know, this is very much generalizing, but he would be the person that would be prescription medicine if there was a medicine to make a cure. And he states there's no magic pill for this. It's only to get back on track, that's rest. All right, so a little bit of organizational challenges. This is a new slides compared to last time, but I just wanted to give you an insight on some of the challenges that we are facing being a small startup. This is some very practical things, enough office space. Like, we are sitting in small offices, we don't have the luxury of having many square meters. For that reason, we often work from home. We haven't set up a way that we should work from home, so it's very much trust-driven. We have an employee sitting in Jutland, so that's like 100 or 200 kilometers from the office. She's not in the office every day. She's not a co-owner of the company. And we haven't put any systems in place to make sure that she actually delivers. So the only thing we do, or we can do, is to basically build it on trust and, of course, see if she thinks she delivers the right results. Knowledge sharing, we're trying to do it as best as we can. But again, we are a small startup company. We can't afford to have too many meetings where we are just sharing whatever we know about things. We need to be efficient. We need to go out, meet customers. We need to close new business, even though we got investors in a while ago. That was not meant to fund the company in this respect, but it was more like building the sales. So that is some of the challenges that we are facing. And I'm sure that Rikke would be able to, or Tine would be able to map it towards some of the star models or the other models that you're using. We're also moving from generalist roles to specialized functions. We used to be two persons in the company. I did everything from bookkeeping to sales and implementations and, you know, you name it. Today, I'm more moving into a manager role and a project design role. Stepped out of sales, at least in the first meetings. But I used to do sales, so I have sort of a floater role in the company, which is sometimes good because I can fit in and help out, but it's also bad because I'm very often maybe stepping on my colleagues' toes because they were just about to do what I suddenly thought I should do. So that's one of the challenges we're facing. Please don't tell any of our customers. So whatever I say in this room can't leave the room and on the video either. I put in the strategy challenged by day-to-day issues. I mean, you design a strategy. Remember, nobody have done this before us in this fashion. I'm not saying nobody have started up company, but we are in a new market. We need to educate the market. We are not 100% sure that all that we do is the right way of doing it. So when suddenly sales slow down through the indirect model, somebody in the team, you're looking at him, might be suggesting, forget about the partners and just go direct, because then we can meet the customers at least ourselves and get the business in faster. So that is the kind of things that are popping up where we are not certain if we're doing the right thing or not. And I would not say it's due to us being immature. We have all been more than 20 years of experience in a various number of companies. So it's not like we do understand the value of keeping the strategy, but it's also been challenged on a day-to-day basis. Another thing that is pushing, that's either no or low salary. Suddenly your private income becomes everybody's business. I was not used to discuss my private income with anyone else than my partner. And suddenly we are a team of four or five partners, and suddenly you need to talk about, okay, what should the salary level be? Can we afford this? Can we afford that? I'm planning to buy a house, so next month we need to do more business, because, you know, all that kind of thing suddenly becomes everybody's business, where maybe you think, I would like to keep this as a private thing because they shouldn't know. But they have to know, because, you know, maybe if you can't stand it, you need to leave the company, and then you're leaving your partners without that resource that was supposed to do sales, and then you might be out of business. So that's also one of the challenges that we, especially small companies, are facing. All right, enough about the company. Should we do a break, 5 minutes break? Or?
Yeah, maybe it's a good time for a break. Should we have a 10-minute break now?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. 10-minute break. We meet up again 5 minutes past.